Greetings. If you are Muslim, I invite you to hear the truth, the real history of John the Baptist's father. Part 1 began our examination of John the Baptist, the first messenger of Malachi 3:1. In Part 2, we examined a network of 10 verses by multiple prophets about the beginning of the gospel. Now, let's examine the events about John's father, Zechariah. Luke 1:1. Many have undertaken to compose an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us. We have 4 gospels, but many wanted to write accounts of the events that happened, just as they were handed down to us by the initial eyewitnesses and servants of the Word. Therefore, having carefully investigated everything from the beginning, it seemed good also to me to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the certainty of the things you have been taught. Luke was careful and investigated everything. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah, and whose wife Elizabeth was a daughter of Aaron. All priests came from the tribe of Levi, so Zechariah must have been a Levite. They were both righteous in the sight of God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and decrees of the Lord. But they had no children because Elizabeth was barren, and both of them were well along in years. A situation not unlike Abraham and Sarah. Both Zechariah and Elizabeth were old, and Elizabeth was barren. One day, while Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, different divisions of the Levites took turns in rotation. It could have been a different division of priests at this time. Not. Consider this one more detail that Yahweh God aligned perfectly. He was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. This is a second draw that Zechariah happened to win, to be serving that day. First, his division had to be on deck, then he had to be picked from his division. And at the hour of the incense offering, the entire congregation was praying outside. Just then, an angel of the Lord appeared to Zechariah, standing at the right side of the altar of the incense. When Zechariah saw him, he, meaning Zechariah, was startled and overcome with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, because your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall give him the name John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He shall never take wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb." Matthew 11:11. "Truly I say to you, among those born of women, there has not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Many of the sons of Israel he will turn back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Notice what I have highlighted in yellow. He will go on before the Lord to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. The angel is now describing John with the phraseology of the first messenger of Malachi 3:1. He will go on before the Lord to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous. Malachi 4:5. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers. Otherwise I will come and strike the land with a curse. So we see another prophecy about John, coming in the spirit and power of Elijah. So Prophet John comes in the spirit and power of Elijah. That's Malachi 4, verse 5 and 6, which is referenced by Luke 1:17. How can I be sure of this? Zechariah asked the angel. I am an old man and my wife is well along in years. Other translations reveal the sentiment in his question. How can I be sure of this? How will I know this for certain? How will I know this is going to happen? How shall I know if this is so? Zechariah is actually questioning the truth of the angel's statement. I am Gabriel, replied the angel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. I sense this as a matter-of-fact recitation of credentials, with just a hint of a whiff of indignance at the distrust of this human being. And now, it is hard to tell if this is a consequence of Zechariah's distrust of Gabriel. And now, you will be silent and unable to speak until the day this comes to pass, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled at their proper time. Notice the length of time. Elizabeth is not yet pregnant. Zechariah will be silent and mute at least 9 months. Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he took so long in the temple. When he came out and was unable to speak to them, they realized he had seen a vision in the temple. He kept making signs to them, but remained speechless. Zechariah went mute immediately on the angel's judgment. But he could make signs, meaning hand signs or motions, and possibly writing. And when the days of his service were completed, he returned home. He kept on serving as priest, even though he was now mute. After these days, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. After Zechariah's time of service as priest ended, he could go home and know Elizabeth. She declared, "The Lord has done this for me. In these days he has shown me favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." So John being conceived was a miracle of God, giving life to a barren womb. In the 6th month, God sent the angel Gabriel to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin pledged in marriage to a man named Joseph, who was of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. 6 months into the pregnancy, Gabriel has another message to give. This time to Mary. The angel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. So the angel told her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you shall give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How can this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." Notice, Mary's question is different than Zechariah's. Not, "Is this true?" But how can this happen? Mary does not challenge the truth of Gabriel or his statement. The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. It does not give a mechanism, and this is where Islam goes into the carnal ditch. Islam is secular and not spiritual. It has no insight into spiritual matters. Teachers of Islam play on this to imply only a sexual act could impregnate the Christian story of Mary. But then Muslims accept the Quran's story that Allah, or Jibreel, the Quran is not clear, blew on Mary's genitals. Surah 66:12, "And Maryam, daughter of Imran, who kept safe her private parts, so we breathed on it of our spirit. And she sincerely believed in the words of her Lord and his books, and she was one of the devout." So evidently this physical act of blowing on into her genitalia is not offensive to Muslims. "Look, even Elizabeth, your relative, has conceived a son in her old age, and she who was called barren is in her sixth month." Couple of points here. Elizabeth and Mary were relatives. Zechariah was Levite. Was Elizabeth also of the tribe of Levi? If so, Mary was a Levite. That would make Jesus a Levite as well. Just thinking out loud here. "Look, even Elizabeth has conceived a son in her old age, and she who was called barren is in her sixth month." Second point, Gabriel spills the beans on Elizabeth's pregnancy with John, including the time, 6 months. "For nothing will be impossible with God." Mary is a virgin God will make pregnant, and Elizabeth is an old barren womb that God has made fertile. "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it happen to me according to your word." Then the angel left her. Notice again, Mary accepted Gabriel's words as true. In those days, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judah, where she entered the home of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. Just shortly after hearing from Gabriel, not months later, it is not even clear if Mary has already conceived. Pay attention in the verses that follow. It does not state that Mary is already pregnant, only that she has the promise, the word from Gabriel. "When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby, John, leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit." This is a verse that confuses Ahmed Didat. He cannot resolve the Holy Spirit in Elizabeth with Didat's theory that Muhammad is the Holy Spirit. Spoiler, that is because Didat is wrong, and Muhammad is not the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, that Jesus promised and sent to his disciples. "And why am I so honored that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" The inspiration of the Holy Spirit reveals that the Lord, meaning God, will be the promised fruit of Mary's womb. "For as soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy." So John, at least 6 months along in development, has awareness enough to react to the presence of Mary. "Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord's word to her will be fulfilled." Here is the clue that Mary is not yet pregnant. Will be fulfilled. The word from Gabriel has not yet been fulfilled. "Then Mary said, 'My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the humble state of his servant. From now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their thoughts of their heart. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has exalted the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful, as he promised to our fathers, to Abraham and his descendants forever. Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. When the time came for Elizabeth to have her child, she gave birth to a son. Her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown her great mercy, and they rejoiced with her. On the eighth day, when they came to circumcise the child, they were going to name him after his father, Zechariah. But his mother replied, "No, he shall be called John." They said to her, "There is no one among your relatives who bears this name." So they made signs to his father to inquire what he wanted to name the child. That's kind of silly. He wasn't deaf. They could have just talked to him. Zechariah asked for a tablet and wrote, so he could write, "His name is John," and they were all astonished. He still could not talk, but he'd had 9 months to think about his words. Immediately, Zechariah's mouth was opened and his tongue was released, and he began to speak, praising God. All their neighbors were filled with awe, and people throughout the hill country of Judea were talking about these events. And all who heard this wondered in their hearts and asked, "What then will this child become? For the Lord's hand was with him." Then his father, Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has visited and redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through his holy prophets, those of ages past. Salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. The oath he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us deliverance from hostile hands, that we may serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our lives. And you, child," he's now prophesying over his son, John, "and you, child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare his ways." John's father, Zechariah, has just ascribed the role as first messenger of Malachi 3:1 to his own son, John. To give to his people knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the dawn will visit us from on high. God will visit, meaning come in the flesh, and John will be the prophet to prepare God's way for him. By which the dawn will visit us from on high. At the time of John's birth, Jesus had not yet been born. It is possible Mary was still not yet pregnant. Nothing has been mentioned about when Mary conceived. To shine on those who live in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the path of peace. And the child grew and became strong in the spirit. And he lived in the wilderness until the time of his public appearance to Israel. Think about just how many events were synchronized and marked by supernatural activity. John in the womb was aware of Mary's presence. Zechariah could not speak for 9 months. Then Zechariah prophesies that John is the first messenger of Malachi 3:1. John is so significant because John is the one who identifies God in the flesh. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.